Amen. Guys, welcome. I'm really excited to be able to share with you guys this morning has put on my heart. Now, I don't know if you guys noticed this, but we should not be here this morning.
What?
Do you guys realize that? I don't know if you guys have been paying attention.
Huh?
Yeah, the world was supposed to end yesterday. There was this Christian author, David Mead, that said that the world was going to end yesterday. I'm pretty sure, given everything else that was going on in the world, it got buried under, you know, all the other news that's been going on. But yeah, guys, we're not supposed to be here. Consequently, they contacted the author and they were like, well, what happened? He said, the world's not going to end. Wasn't going to end yesterday. But it's going to end by October. He hasn't given out a date. So obviously with all this talk, an idea came across my mind. I said, you know, how many times has the end of the world been predicted? Those that know me, I love stats. I love doing research. There's been over 184 predictions that the world is going to end, you know, since they started keeping track. At least 184. The most recent before yesterday was, you guys know, December 21st, 2012.
Yeah.
The world was supposed to end on the equinox, and, you know, people were tripping, buying bunkers and all that good stuff. There was a movie made about it, and it didn't happen. And so now the author that said October, the next supposed end of the world date is in 2020. I think it's September or something, 2020. So we got a couple years before we gotta, you know, freak out. I was thinking about all these days, and I'm like, you know what? When you look at it, when I heard about the day, I was like, oh, whatever, man. Like, the world's not gonna end. Like, the Bible even says, like, you're not gonna know, like, you know, when Jesus is coming back, it's gonna be like that. But I started, honestly, guys, freaking out a little bit, to my shame. And what happens is, you know, the earthquakes that have been going on, you know, Mexico, you know, brothers and sisters are all right, but there's a lot of devastation in Mexico right now. Two earthquakes. Of course, the hurricanes in Florida and Houston for the flooding. And then, you know, it's not even mentioned, like, the political stuff going on. We're not going to delve into that, but there's a lot that's going on that, to me, I was like, you know what, man, like, there is a lot, it seems like tension is heightened. Like, there's a lot of unrest around the world, a lot going on, and I even started to think, like, man, like, all right, well, things are getting a little crazy, like, and sadly, you know, I started, like, there's a couple times where I started to think, like, man, like, what if the world is ending this Saturday? Afterwards, I felt silly for thinking about it, but I went there. And so, obviously, I started thinking, why do people freak out so much about, you know, these doomsday prophecies and all those things? Most people are thinking about, like, the crazy stuff that's going to happen, you know, fully, you know, doom and destruction, fire and brimstone, all that good stuff. But to me, that's not even the scariest thing about the end of the world, hell, all those different topics. That's not even the scariest thing to me. So I thought I'd share what the scariest thing about, you know, the end of the world will be. And interestingly enough, we find the concept in the book of Judges. More so about the story of Samson. And so I thought I'd share with you what God's kind of put in my heart in regards to this. And like I said, Sally, I started to think, guys. I started to get, like, I even shared back when we had, like, the wildfires, you know, going on. Like, there's part of me that wanted to, like, panic and, like, freak out and say, you know, like, man, what is going on in the world? And so the crazy thing is that the crazy thing about hell and the end of the world is that people, like, the Bible says, every knee shall bow, right? Every name will proclaim that Jesus is Lord. The scariest thing is knowing that, hey, there, for those that didn't believe in God, the scariest thing is knowing that there is a God, one, and that they turned their back on him. Turn me to Luke 16. There's a cool little story before you jump in. In Luke 16, that I think encompasses kind of like what people are feeling. Luke 16.
Okay, David.
in verse 19. The Bible reads, says, there was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. The time came when the beggar died and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In hell, where he was in torment, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue because I am in agony in this fire. But Abraham replied, son, remember in your lifetime you received your good things while Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted here and you are in agony. And besides all this, between us and you a great chasm has been fixed so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor anyone cross over from there to us. And right here, this paints like a pretty sobering picture of what I imagine the feeling would be like. Here we have a guy that is in hell in torment. And he looks up and he sees the angel. And he's trying to get comfort. And the angel said, hey, there's a great chasm between us. There's nothing that can be done right now. It is too late. And this guy is sitting here knowing like he squandered his life and knowing that there's nothing he can do about it. In hell, like the scariest thing about it is that you're separated from God, one, and that you consciously know that there is God and there's nothing that can be done about it. The title of my lesson this morning, guys, is Hell on Earth. Mm. Hell on Earth. Why do I say that? Why hell on earth? Because that's what people tend to describe, like, you know, the end of the world and all that stuff. It's literally going to be hell on earth. But I put before you that's not even the scariest thing about it. Go with me to Judges 13, and we're going to pick up our story.
Come on, Amy.
Hell on Earth is the title of my lesson. The first point is understand the times. Understand the times. In Judges 13, in verse 1, the Bible reads, again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. So the Lord delivered them into the hands of the Philistines for 40 years. Now, we can stop right there. Now, the thing that immediately took me aback when I read this is the Bible starts off saying, again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. That means that this wasn't the first time, right? Mm-hmm. And a lot of people don't understand, like, the whole point of judges, which means leaders, is that God sent judges because the people needed to be led. And here we read that it says, hey, again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. And if you read earlier in Judges 6, the Bible says that each time God brought a judge is because the Israelites were doing more evil than the time before.
Yeah.
Wow. So here we're in Judges 13, right? So you can only imagine how much evil was going on in the world at this time.
Yeah.
They were in some deep stuff. The Bible even says again, he says for 40 years that he handed them over to the Philistines. My first question to you guys is, like, do you guys understand the times that we're in right now? One of the things that I've been thinking about this whole week is just the state of the world.
Yeah.
Obviously, we all know, the world, there's a part of the world that doesn't believe in God, doesn't want anything to do with God. And then there's a portion of people that do believe in God, but sadly aren't living their lives for God. And we can conceptually understand that, but I feel like this week even more than others, like you've actually like seen it, right? You've seen like, man, like how lost this world is. Again, from, you know, the stuff going on in the world, like the violence that you see on TV, you only have to, you know, scroll through your Facebook feed to where your story pops up about something crazy happening. In the world, like the world is in a dark place. Do you understand the times that are going on, how lost the world is? Here in the Bible it says, hey, again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. Like the state of Israel, they're in a dark place.
Yeah.
And God hands them over to the Philistines. We can forget why judges are sent. We can forget the purpose that is needed is because God's people have strayed away from him. Jump to 14, chapter 14, verse 1. You get the sense, even a greater sense of where people are at. So check this out. Israel is doing evil in the eyes of the Lord. He hands them over to the Philistines. And so this is where Samson is born and set apart. He grows up. He's set apart by God. And chapter 14, verse 1, Samson is older. And the Bible reads, Samson went down to Timnah and saw there a young Philistine woman. When he returned, he said to his father and mother, I have seen a Philistine woman in Timnah. Now get her for me as my wife. So check this out. Samson is here, right? He's alive. Like, we all know the story of Samson. He's here to save God's people. But here in chapter 14, verse 1, this guy is looking for a Philistine wife. Mm-hmm. The Philistines who were the Israelites are in captivity with. What does that say about where Samson is? Like, the apathy and the ungodliness that has even crept into his life. And I feel like that can be us if we're not careful. We can start to allow the state of the world, the state of where things are at, to start infecting our own lives, to where we don't even see how far we've drifted. We don't even understand where things are at. Is that your life right now? Are you allowing the challenges, the stress, the state of the world to influence your life? Because that's what happened with Samson. This guy was set apart, and if you read, I definitely encourage you to read the whole story of Samson. This guy was set apart from birth to be a leader for God's people, and this guy is grown up. He understands, he knows this, and yet he too is influenced by the time. Apathy had taken hold of Israel, and sadly had taken hold of him. And I start to ask myself, have I become apathetic? Have I become apathetic to where the state of the world is? And like I said earlier, I started to be influenced by where the world is at, to start really think, man, like, okay, is the world ending? Like, man, things are getting a little crazy. And sadly, that didn't really affect, you know, my day-to-day life. It just made me scared. Has apathy affected your walk with God? Have you become apathetic to where you are even? I put it for you, if we have become apathetic, we've forgotten God's grace. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 4 real quick.
Come on, bro.
Have you become apathetic? And sadly, you know, we hear enough crazy stories that we start to become numb to it, right? It doesn't surprise us when we hear crazy things going on. In Hebrews chapter 4, Bible says, let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us out in our time of need. I've also been reading a lot about God's grace, and truly trying to understand God's grace to especially as a tool to snap myself out of an apathetic state of mind. When we forget God's grace, when we forget what God has done for us, that's when we start to become apathetic. We start to become, you know, numb to what's going on. And that's what was going on with Samson. You know, he had forgotten his purpose. He had started to allow the world to influence his life. He had become apathetic. My challenge for you guys this morning, if you become apathetic, if you're feeling like, hey, you know, numb to what's going on, to the state of the world, to get open, to talk about it. Talk about what's going on in your life, so that you can one, understand God's grace and what He's done for you and your calling. When we become apathetic, we not only start to look like the world, guys, but we forget our purpose.
Mm-hmm.
It's extremely important. We can't get into the state that Samson was in Judges 14. Another thing too that I noticed. Was that there's something that I stopped doing daily, and that is making daily decisions. My second point, daily decisions. In Judges 14, so Samson is born, he's set apart, he takes the Nazarite vow, where no razor can be used on his head, so he's never gotten a haircut, so his hair, you know, he's got this nice, luxurious mane of hair, but this guy is set apart from God. And obviously, right off the bat, you know, we see that he's kind of lost his way. But there's three decisions that I want us to look at that Samson made that I feel are applicable to what we're going through today. In Judges 14. So after he goes after a Philistine wife in 14 verse 3, Bible reads, his father and mother replied, "Isn't there an acceptable woman among your relatives or among all our people? Must she go to the uncircumcised Philistines to get a wife?" But Samson said to his father, "Get her for me. She is the right one for me." His parents did not know that this was from the Lord, who was seeking an occasion to confront the Philistines, for at that time they were ruling over Israel. So Samson went down to Timnah together with his father and mother. As they approached the vineyards of Timnah, suddenly a young lion came roaring towards them. The Spirit of the Lord came upon him in power so that he tore the lion apart with his bare hands, as he might have torn a young goat. But he told neither his father nor his mother what he had done. Then he went down and talked with the woman, and he liked her. Sometime later, when he went back to marry her, he turned aside and looked at the lion's carcass. In it was a swarm of bees and some honey, which he scooped out with his hands and ate as he went along. When he rejoined his parents, he gave them some, and they too ate it, but he did not tell them that he had taken the honey from the lion's carcass. Now, first thing I want to point out, the decision that Samson made is the decision to be silent. Here we see that he doesn't talk about what happened with the lion. And then he doesn't tell his parents about the fact that he goes to this carcass and scoops out this honey and gives it to his parents. Now, for those that don't know, like touching a dead animal, you become defiled in Jewish law. So not only did he himself become defiled, he allows his parents to become defiled by touching a dead animal. And he doesn't say anything. That was one decision. He ate the honey in verse 9. Those decisions right there are not only continue to cement Samson's fate, but also seal the fate of his parents. So he goes on. There's a lot of craziness that happens after this. I definitely guys are going to read what the trouble Samson got into. And then later on, he goes in and he meets this woman, Delilah. Now I don't know about you. I know there's not many people want to be named Delilah. From this, you know, so, you know, I always look at people weird when they want to name their daughter Delilah or Jezebel. Why would you do that? But here he goes and after he goes and marries the Philistine, he meets this woman Delilah, who is up to no good. This woman is trying to aid the Philistines and capture Samson. And so he goes and meets this woman, starts to continue to go further and further away from his calling. And then this woman, Delilah, is trying to capture Samson and trying to learn the secret of his strength. So she's asking him time after time, "Hey, why are you so strong? Like, why can't the Philistines capture you? How are you able to do what you're able to do?" And eventually, he sets up some games for her where he doesn't tell her what's the secret to his strength. Until in chapter 16, we pick up in verse 9. After constant prodding, Samson finally gives in. In verse 9, it says, "With men hidden in the room, she called him, 'Samson, the Philistines are upon you.' But he snapped the thongs as easy as a piece of string snaps when it comes close to a flame. So the secret of his strength was not discovered. Then Delilah said to Samson, 'You have made a fool of me. You lied to me. Come now, tell me how you can be tied.' He said, 'If anyone ties me securely with new ropes that have never been used, I'll become as weak as any other man.' So Delilah took new ropes and tied them with them. Then with men hidden in the room, she called to him, 'Samson, the Philistines are upon you.' But he snapped the ropes off his arms as they were threads. Delilah then said to Samson, 'Until now you have been making a fool of me, lying to me. Tell me now how you can be tied.' It says, he replied, 'If you weave the 7 braids of my head into the fabric of the loom and tighten with the pin, I'll become as weak as any other man.' So while he was sleeping, Delilah took the 7 braids of his head and wove them into the fabric and tightened with the pin. Again, he called to him, Samson, the Philistines are upon you. He awoke from his sleep and pulled up the pin and the loom with the fabric. Then she said to him, how can you say I love you when you won't confide in me? This is the third time you have made a fool of me and haven't told me the secret of your great strength. With such nagging, she prodded him day after day until he was tired to death. Man, I can only imagine that relationship. Hopefully that doesn't describe your relationship. He says, so he told her everything. No razor has ever been used on my head. He said, because I have been a Nazirite set apart to God since birth. If my head were shaved, my strength would leave me, and I would become as weak as any other man. Now, we just stop right there. What stuck out to me is this. Now, we know, reading this, was this the true source of Samson's strength? The fact that his hair hadn't been cut. Was that the reason why he was so? No, like that wasn't why he was so strong. It's because God had given him strength and had set him apart. The decision that Samson made here, a lot of people said, "Hey, why did he share?" It may seem like he shared the secret right here, but when you read into it, Samson, he had become so arrogant that he even believed that, "Hey, man, yeah, that's the source of my strength. Like, yeah, my hair." And I believe this is when God was like, "Yep, like, I can't use this guy anymore." He really believes that it's not God it's not me who's giving him the strength. It's actually in his hair. When in fact he was already set apart from God, the Nazirite vow was something that God just said he just needs to take. Mm-hmm. And so he shares the quote unquote secret to his strength. And then he says, when Delilah saw that he had told her everything in verse 18, she sent word to the rulers of the Philistines, "Come back once more. He has told me everything." So the rulers of the Philistines returned with the silver in their hands. Having put him asleep on her lap, she called a man to shave off the 7 braids of his hair. So he began to subdue him, and his strength left him. Then she called out, "Samson, the Philistines are upon you." He woke from his sleep and thought, "I'll go on as before and shake myself free." But he did not know that the Lord had left him. Then the Philistines seized him, gouged out his eyes, and took him down to Gaza, binding him with bronze shackles. They set him to grinding in the prison, but the hair on his head began to grow again after it had been shaved. Here we see kind of like the culmination of all of the little decisions that Samson had been making up to this point. When I read this, I thought it kind of dawned upon me. There's this video that I saw on Facebook. I'm blanking on the woman's name. I was trying to find it again. It was one of those kind of TED Talks type things. This woman was sharing about a time in her life where she was just at rock bottom. She had just lost her job. Her marriage wasn't going well, to where she started, a depression started to come over her, where she didn't even want to get out of bed. And she said, you know, it wasn't until one day she decided to kind of play this trick on her mind, trick of mind, where she would count to 3 and decide to just to jump out of bed, kind of like a rock shit. Like 1, 2, 3, she'd jump out of bed. So she did that one day, and she was able to get out of bed, and that was the first time in, like, months that she, like, got out of bed. And so the next day, she decided to do the same thing. Once she got out of bed, she started feeling better and better. And then one day, she kind of said it kind of dawned on me. He said, every single day, we make tiny decisions that seal our, that cement our future, that can either help propel us forward or keep us back. And says, I just had to look at these tiny decisions and decide to just make those tiny decisions to move forward. And this, with Samson, in the same way, this guy, we're seeing the culmination of little decisions that he decided to make that cemented his fate and that more often than not drove him further away from God and further away from the purpose that God had in his life. It's daily decision. I thought about each day, that's the same way with us. We choose to make daily decisions that are going to get us closer to God or further away. Mm-hmm. Case in point, you wake up. You either decide to have your time with God or not, mm-hmm. right? Say if you do have your time with God, do you decide to challenge yourself, to make, you know, a radical change in your life? Like, we should always, when we read the Bible, be challenging ourselves to do something that day. Do you do that? When we come across people, do we make the decision to share our faith and what God is doing in our lives? Or do we make the decision to be silent? Do we make the decision to really get open about where we are in our lives? silence, or we make the decision to be silent in that area as well. Little decisions that we make every single day, guys, that bring us further away from God or bring us closer to God. Like, this is the example that, Samson has laid out for us of what not to do, right? Little decisions that further took him further away from God. And it really convicted me because I looked at my life, so how many decisions do I make daily that aren't the right decisions, that aren't helping me? And it doesn't have to be something, you know, like we see like kind of like the extreme with Samson. It can be just little things, decisions to not dwell on certain thoughts, decision to move on from a slight that you receive from your coworker, or those little thoughts of discouragement. The little decisions that we make every day, guys, have a big lasting impact. My challenge for you guys is to make those decisions daily that are going to bring you closer to God and not further. Amen. And to treat those little each decision as big as an impact as they truly are. If we don't treat those decisions as important as they are, then we won't want to make the right one. I know for me, I had a really what I've been doing this week. I share when I wake up, I have to like tell myself like, man, today is gonna be awesome. Mm-hmm. Kind of, I've never been like that type of, you know, do the positive chants and same things that people say. But I the week before, my wife will tell you like, I did not want to go into work. I started to kind of like just hate my job. I started to hate my job because I felt like I should be doing something else. And it started to weigh on me negatively. Like I could tell, like, you guys know that feeling, you don't want to go to work. Like you're not excited. You're just like, man, like thinking about what you're going to do when it hits 5 o'clock.
Yeah.
I started to, and it started to affect me spiritually. And I said, you know, I have to really wake up and make the decision that today is going to be awesome, that work is going to be great, and that it's going to be awesome.
Yeah.
And I saw that when I started doing that, work started to become awesome. Like people, my boss wasn't on me. She was like cool, like doesn't say anything. There was even a couple days she didn't come into work. my relationship with my boss is awesome, but you know, there's times when things can happen, it can set your day off on the wrong course. So once I started doing that, I realized how easy things got. And it clicked when I saw this video. It's like, you know what? Every day we make decisions that impact us further than we can ever know. I bet if Samson can understand, hey, these decisions you're making, Samson, are going to lead you to having your eyes gouged out, all these things. I'm willing to bet he would have done differently. That's why we read the story, right? We read this cautionary tale. Say, hey, the decisions you make daily have an impact.
Yeah.
This guy went from lusting with his eyes to having his eyes gouged out.
Mm.
He went from being the strongest guy around to being trapped and chained up. He went from being able to do really whatever he wanted to being enslaved. His life totally changed because of decisions he made. Let's be men and women that make the right decisions daily, guys.
Amen.
My final point is that we need to realize redemption. In Judges 16, Samson gets captured. This guy goes from being this perceived hero to really a circus freak, in a sense. He goes from putting on shows for the Philistines. And Judges 16, verse 23, says, now the rulers of the Philistines assembled to offer a great sacrifice to Dagon, their god, and to celebrate, saying, our God has delivered Samson, our enemy, into our hands. Now that right there, like, check how serious this situation is right now. Samson in his life didn't give glory to God. Now, this is how God flipped it on him. He is now giving glory to the gods of the Philistines. Not by choice, but by him being captured and put on display and performing. These guys are, hey, we're going to do this to give glory to our God. And it's so important. Like, when we don't give glory to God, when we don't fulfill the purpose that we're called to, we're in fact glorifying Satan, guys. Because we're allowing ourselves to be used not for God, but for Satan. And that's what happened to Samson here. He had gone from not glorifying God to now the Philistines are glorifying their God through him. When the people saw him, they praised their God, saying, our God has delivered our enemy into our hands, the one who laid waste to our land and multiplied our slain. While they were in high spirits, They shouted, "Bring out Samson to entertain us." So they called Samson out of the prison, and he performed for them. When they stood among the pillars, Samson said to the servants who held his hand, "Put me where I can feel the pillars that support the temple, so that I may lean against them." I would imagine, like, if we could talk to Samson in this point, it's pretty easy to say this is the lowest point of Samson's life. For him, it probably was, you know, if you use the term, hell on earth for him. This guy at the culmination of his life, just thinking about, hey, I'm not supposed to be here. I'm supposed to be leading God's people, not put on display, for the Philistines. When I read this, it dawned on me, like, when we think about, you know, end of times or rapture, hell, the scariest thing, again, about hell isn't, you know, when I was growing up, my parents used to say, you know, fire and brimstone, all this weird thing. But the scariest thing isn't all that. The scariest thing is being separated from God.
Yeah.
And not only that, but knowing that you willingly deny God, deny his purpose for you, and there's nothing that can be done about it. Yeah. I'd imagine that's what's going on with Samson right here. He's saying, hey, I have not lived up to my potential. I have not lived out my purpose. And he knowingly knows it. And there's nothing he can do about it. He's blind. He's shackled. No strength. This guy, he was going through hell at this point. And that's what it can be like, guys. And the thing that even added to it is that's how hell can, we can be living in hell at this point right now, is when we're not living for God. When we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing, when there's no presence of God in our lives, that's what hell is. We can be living like that at this moment. But the crazy thing is, this may be seem like, you know, a pretty like crazy tale story that we're reading, but in Hebrews 11, if you can jump there, something that always used to I guess, just keep real, it used to confuse me. In Hebrews 11, it's a really popular chapter in the Bible. In Hebrews 11, in verse 32, the writer is listing about, talking about faith. Hebrews 11 is about faith, and the writer is listing off all these heroes in the faith in the Bible. In Hebrews 11, 32, the Bible reads, "And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell you about Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies."
Wow.
So here we see Samson makes it into the hall of faith that's been returned. When I read the story of Samson, I'm like, man, like what was it about Samson that got him into the hall of faith? Like, when I read the story, I'm like, man, like, okay, Samson, like, he went through some stuff. Like, he got captured, by the Philistines. If we go back to Judges, let's read about what happened. See if we can figure this thing out.
This is awesome.
Back in Judges 16, in verse 27, it says, "Now the temple was crowded with men and women. All the rulers of the Philistines were there. And on the roof were about 3,000 men and women watching Samson perform. Then Samson prayed to the Lord, 'Oh, sovereign Lord, remember me. Oh, God, please strengthen me just once more, and let me with one blow get revenge on the Philistines for my two eyes.' Then Samson reached towards the two central pillars on which the temple stood, bracing himself against them, his right hand on the one and his left hand on the other. Samson said, 'Let me die with the Philistines.' Then he pushed with all his might, and down came the temple on the rulers and all the people in it. Thus he killed many more when he died than while he lived. Then his brothers and his father's whole family went down to get him. They brought him back and buried him between Zorah and Eshtol in the tomb of Manoah, his father. He had led Israel 20 years. And so, obviously, you know, we had the term Samson went out with a bang. But when I read this, I'm like, okay, like, what about this garnered, you know, his mention in Hebrews 11? And then it struck me in verse 30 when he says, let me die with the Philistines. Samson is like, is at this point where he truly realized the sacrifice that needed to be made. And I believe this is a microcosm of the sacrifice we all are called to. He was called to give up his life in order to fulfill his purpose by taking out the Philistines. He was willing to give himself, to sacrifice himself to fulfill his purpose.
Amen.
And I thought it's the same thing for us. Are we willing to die to ourselves to see God's purpose fulfilled? Not saying we need to go out and like try to like take out a bunch of Philistines and destroy stuff, but do we have the heart to sacrifice our lives, sacrifice the life that we may feel like we want for God, to see God's purpose fulfilled in our lives? I believe that that's what garnered Samson this mention in Hebrews 11, is that he finally fulfilled his purpose in the end, and it took him being willing to give up his life. In Philippians, you don't have to turn there. Philippians chapter 2, verse 12, 13 says, therefore, my friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it's God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. Mm-hmm. Samson understood that I needed to fulfill God's purpose and not my own. And it's the same thing for us. Are we willing to fulfill God's purpose in our lives? That may mean like we might have to give up some things. That may mean that what we want for our lives is not what God wants, and we need to be okay with that.
Yeah.
Samson was, I feel, finally accepted that, hey, it's not about me anymore. It's about God and his purpose.
Yeah.
We got to live out our purpose. It's not too late. If you're here breathing right now, like, it's not too late to live out your purpose and fulfill it. One of the saddest things to me about Samson's story, obviously it ends great. But even, the Bible mentions, he killed more when he died than when he left. He even after all that, he still, he never reached his true potential for his life. Mm. Yeah, he made it in the end. Like, that's awesome. Like, we all, at the end of the day, want that to be said, that we made it. But I don't know about you, but I want to live out, I want to fulfill what God has put me on earth to do now. Not when it's in the end. Samson, that was his story. He never did everything that he was supposed to do. Yes, he ended gloriously, but he went through a lot of crazy things. We can't buy into the hysteria, guys, of the world and what's going on and when Jesus is coming back and predictions and things like that. Those things shouldn't scare us. They shouldn't waver us. And if they are, I encourage you, get into your word, pray, let us talk. Don't buy into the hype. What we should be fearful about is living life now without God, without God in our lives. We should be scared about that. We should be scared about not living out our purpose while we're here on earth. For me, that was the theme that God drilled in this week, that I don't want to be, for sports term, I don't want to be like, a has-been, a guy that like, could have done this, or man, he had all the talent to do this, but now he could have made it to the big leagues, but he's working at the market right now. I don't want to be that cautionary tale, right? Mm. I don't want to be, the Samson where we look like, man, this guy could have did so much while he was alive. I don't want that to be me. So the challenge, guys, is to live your life for God now, to live out your purpose now while you're breathing, to not buy into the hype, to realize that hell on earth literally is, living your life without God, and we've been given the honor of knowing what it means to live for God. So let's be about our purpose, guys. To God be glory. Amen. So, guys, just like Samson sacrificed his life, obviously, everything draws us parallel with Jesus and his sacrifice. We cannot forget the sacrifice Jesus made. There's a scripture in Hebrews. Hebrews 12, in verse 1, the Bible says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders us and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning his shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Again, this is right after the writer talks about those heroes in the faith. And of course, you got to mention Jesus. And the thing that struck me most about this passage is that what got Jesus through the cross, what got Jesus through that sacrifice that he made, is the joy set before him, the joy of knowing that, hey, that I'm going to be with God, I'm going to be with the Father by going through the sacrifice. And I'm going to have brothers and sisters with me by doing this. And so just like Samson understood, hey, I got to, my life has to end for me to fulfill my purpose, is the same thing with Jesus. And so when we take the bread and the juice, remember that the sacrifice that Jesus made for us, and that we're called to have a sacrificial life that honors God, so that we can be with him in the end. So with that, let's pray for the bread and the juice. Dear Heavenly Father, we're just grateful to be called by the scriptures, grateful to be called by our brothers and sisters in the past that we read about, that gave up so much, Lord, that sacrificed so much, that we can have the stories, that we can have the lessons that we hear today, Father. And most importantly, Lord, we have Jesus, our brother Jesus' example of sacrifice, that he lived out his purpose, and that he too understand that sacrifice was needed to be made for us to be saved. Father, I pray that we can remember that we too can take upon ourselves to live sacrificial lives that glorify you, Lord, that honor you, Father. It's in this moment, Lord, where we think about that, we meditate on that, Lord, and really dedicate ourselves, our hearts and our minds to you, Father. I pray that we can remember that we can continuously not only remember, but live lives of sacrifice, Lord. Thank you for Jesus' example. Thank you for your scriptures. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.